Welcome to our broadcast with multiple Grammy Awards, Ace Awards, a People's Choice Award, and count them, 11 platinum albums. He is a member of the Songwriters Hall of Fame. Billy Joel is one of the most successful and important singer-songwriters of the last two decades. Songs such as The Piano Man, Just the Way You Are, Allentown, We Didn't Start the Fire, The Downeaster Alexa, to name a few, reveal the spirit of the songwriter and reflect the passions of our times. His latest release, River of Dreams, entered the charts at number one. It is his most personal music endeavor to date. He joins us now on the New York leg of his current world tour. He's at the Madison Square Garden for 6 engagements. And he's also the subject of an In the Spotlight special, Shades of Grey, which will air on PBS this coming Wednesday, October 13th. It's a pleasure to have him here for this hour. Welcome.
Thank you.
It's really great to have you here.
Thanks.
I have enjoyed your music for a long time, and especially this. And I really want to begin by talking. I'll hold this up. The album, the front of this album was done by Christy Brinkley.
My wife painted the album cover. That's right.
Yeah. And the River of Dreams is the, what do we call that?
The title song.
Yeah. Tell me about what this represents for you and where you are as an artist reflected in this album.
Well, you mentioned before it's the most personal body of work I've done. And I would have to say that's what makes this one different than the other albums I've done. There was always a certain amount of personal interjection in the other albums, but this one is completely, yeah, from first song to the last song, dealing with you know, things to do with me. And also, I'm 44, and it's a strange age for a rock and roll guy to find himself, because I always assumed there was some sort of mandatory age retirement in this, yeah, gig.
But you and McCartney and many others find out that there seems to be no ceiling, or no one yet has found it.
That's true. They keep pushing the edge of the envelope.
Yeah. Oh. And you will continue as long as you feel like you have something to say.
Well, I will continue to write. I find that the composing, the musical composition, is really the substantive part of my work. The performing, I may let that go. I may walk away from that in the not-too-distant future. The personality aspect of it is not as appealing to me as it once was. Yeah.
The concerts themselves are not?
No, they're not. I enjoy playing, and I like interacting with other musicians, but the touring becomes a grind, and I would rather spend the energy on creating music.
It also, and you talk about this, and you have said this in interviews you have done, is that one of the things about coming to adulthood, which defines it for you, was having a child. One of these songs is devoted to him and is dedicated to her, Lullaby. And it takes you away from your daughter at an important time in her life.
Yes. Yes, it does. I always had said when I was young, because my parents had split up and we didn't have a father at home, that when I had my own children, I was going to be home for them. And I find myself being the traveling salesman and being away from home, and it's not what I had in mind. It's not, yeah, what I wanted. Yeah.
Let me talk about some of these songs, and then talk about you as a musician. No Man's Land is about really an indictment. What I find interesting, an indictment of the mauling of America and, mm, suburban America, and you are in some ways a man of suburban America.
Yes, I am.
Yeah.
I grew up in the quintessential housing development, Levittown.
Yeah.
The first one, which was actually a very good idea. If you were a GI coming back from World War II for $40 down, you could have a house in what was considered the country.
Yeah. I mean, David Halberstam did a book on the 50s, and he talks about William Levitt as one of the people who shaped that decade.
Absolutely.
By what he offered to people, and especially in Levittown on Long Island.
Absolutely. When you think about the baby boom really growing up mostly in suburbia, yeah, we weren't inner city kids. We weren't kids from the country. Most of this baby boom grew up in some sort of suburban housing development. Mm-hmm. I think you'll find that. We didn't, you know, I don't think our parents knew what was going to be the downside of this. Mm-hmm. They saw it as all as the upside. And my generation, I think, is dealing with some of the downside of that. We watched small town America disappear. We watched the local Main Street disappear. Mm-hmm. The mall took over. The mall culture took over. Mm-hmm. And that's part of what that song is about.
But I suspect that part of you is still there in terms of the roots that you have, despite all that being a popular musician and a very successful musician has done to you, the ups and downs, that part of your soul and part of who you are is still there.
Well, sure. I mean, all my formative years were spent living in a neighborhood with other people who were basically transplanted city people. It was all people from Brooklyn, Queens, and the Bronx.
Who moved out for a better quality.
Yeah, who moved, 25 to 30 miles outside of town. We all played city games, though. Stickball, Ring-a-Leave-yo, yeah. Johnny on the Pony, chicken fights. It was basically city people living in a suburb.
Yeah. When did you first have any inkling of music in your life?
Well, as long as I can remember, I heard music. My father was a classical pianist. He learned to play the piano in Germany. He was brought up in Germany. My mother grew up in a family that was a bunch of Gilbert and Sullivan buffs. And actually, that's how my parents met at CCNY. I think it was in the late 30s. They met during a Gilbert and Sullivan production of, I think it was HMS Pinafore, The Mikado, one of those.
Right.
And all my life, I heard music from the time I was a little kid.
And when did you start playing the piano?
Well, I think I started banging the piano before I actually learned to play.
That's right. That's
there
right.
was an old upright, a Lester upright, that was over in the living room, and I would just walk over to it and bang when I was a little kid. And one day my mom said, look, you're going to bang this thing and learn how to bang it right. And she dragged me, kicking and screaming, down the street to the piano teacher.
And you were what, five, six?
I was 4 years old.
4 years old, mm-hmm. Yeah. Did it take, did you like it, or were you saying to this teacher, I'd rather be outside playing ball?
I would rather have been outside playing ball, to tell you the truth, but it took, despite my protestations, to the contrary. I didn't like having to practice every day. I didn't, I hated homework, so. And then on top of that, having to practice the piano, who needed this?
Yeah.
Plus, I grew up in a neighborhood where if you walked down the street to the piano teacher with your piano books under your arm, you were in big trouble already. So where are you
in
going?
In my neighborhood, too.
Absolutely. Yeah. The same piano teacher also gave ballet lessons.
Yeah.
So I would get a lot of
worse.
Absolutely. Where's your tutu?
And, yeah, exactly.
And I got.
Let's see you dance now, kid.
There you go. Yeah. I got kicked around a little bit because of it. But it took. I really did like the music. I was always enchanted by music.
Did you have an ear early? Because there's this wonderful story. I think the guy's name was Chuck Arnold. Was that his name?
Mm-hmm.
Who hears you playing and you're just banging out something that you know by ear. This was later when you were in high school.
Right.
And he comes in, and he says to you, "What you? What does he say?"
He says, "You're full of baloney." He says, you never learned that from music. You're just faking it." And I said, "That's right." He goes, "That's the best faking I've ever heard. I want you in my music class." And I got transferred into his class.
This was the Hicksville High School chorus or something?
At Hicksville High School. Well, he also taught music history. Yeah. He taught a music appreciation class. And from an early age, I learned how to play by ear. Maybe it was based on laziness.
Yeah.
I don't know. I got tired of reading the dots.
Yeah.
The dots to me were too orthodox. They were too strict. They left no room for spontaneity. And I would actually listen on the radio or play the records that my parents had of the classical pieces I was supposed to learn and learn it that way.
Yeah,
I learned
that way. I would assume that's something that's a rare talent for you, to be able to have that kind of ear. I mean, obviously that was what Chuck Arnold and some other people have recognized in you, was that some gift.
It is a gift. I always tended to denigrate the word talent because talent without hard work doesn't mean anything.
Yeah.
But there is a talent. There is a gift. I see it in my own daughter. She has instant melody retention. She can hear something once and sing it back to you, almost note for note. That is a gift. Yeah.
Your dad survived a concentration camp.
They left Germany in the 30s.
So it wasn't at the worst of the concentration camp.
It was at the beginning of the roundups, the beginning of the, the concentrating of different, groups of Jews and gypsies and undesirables. Now, they got out. They got out before the worst of it happened and came to. They actually didn't come to America. He had to go to Cuba because I think there was some kind of quota on the immigration at that point. They went to Cuba first, then they came here.
Yeah. And when did he leave home, your home and your mother's home, to go back to Europe? How old were you?
I was around my daughter's age, almost 8 years old, when my parents split up and my father went back to Europe.
What did that do to you?
In some ways, it was a very sad thing for me. In other ways, I had a very loving upbringing. A lot of boys I knew my own age were afraid of their fathers. They were somewhat suppressed by dad. And I had no suppression at all. I had complete, freedom in what I could do. In a way, I was spoiled, I guess, because I was brought up by women. I wasn't worried about getting hit.
Yeah.
So I got away with murder. On the other hand, I was allowed to flourish as an artist and as a musician. That was encouraged.
Something you wanted to do or something you had to do as you became a teenager in order to bring home some supplement for the family income?
Well, I recognized early on, my mother went into the workforce in the late 50s. It was not an easy time for women to just go out and find work and compete with men for jobs. She could only find menial work, bookkeeping, if she was lucky, secretarial, and she didn't get paid very much and got kicked around. I watched the system kind of beat her up a lot, and it made me very angry about people being bullied and people being pushed around, because I watched it happen to her. And she is a very gifted person, a very intelligent person, and was not able to bring those talents and bring that intellect into the workforce, and it should have been allowed to have happened. But we weren't dirt poor. We were just scratching by on the income she was making, and I recognized early on that if I could bring in some extra money, it would help. It would help our family.
So pretty soon you're out doing gigs in the 60s and staying up late at night and playing. And you knew pretty soon there that rather than going to college, you were going to be a musician.
I knew early on I wasn't going to go to college. I couldn't wait to get out of high school. As a matter of fact, I didn't graduate.
You didn't, yeah.
I didn't graduate with my class. It was 67 I was supposed to graduate. I didn't get out. I got to the end and they said, well, we didn't graduate you because you didn't show up often enough. Because I'd been working till 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock in the morning at clubs, bringing home some income. And I said, well, okay, I'm not going to go to Columbia University. I want to go to Columbia Records.
Yeah.
And I did.
You first went out to Los Angeles, did you not, before the Columbia Records thing, or was that after?
I was actually signed to a record label called Family Records about 1970, 71. And it was a deal I was, very unhappy with. I pretty much signed away everything, copyrights, publishing, a lot of record royalties. And I found myself in a bad deal. So I moved out to Los Angeles and hid out.
Yeah. Played under the name Bill Martin, was it?
And I played in a piano bar. It was in the Wilshire District, a place called the Executive Room. And I went under the name Bill Martin, which is my middle name. By the way, my real name is Joel, William Martin Joel. So it was Bill Martin at the keyboards.
Yeah.
And I got, union scale, and I got tips. And for 6 months, I played in this piano bar. And the other side, who had me signed to this bad deal, realized that they weren't going to get anything out of me. They might as well negotiate. And that's when the Columbia Records deal came into the picture.
Yeah. And then Piano Man came along soon after that?
Piano Man came out, and I wrote it and recorded it in 73, actually 20 years ago,
yeah.
20 years ago, just about now, and came out early in 74.
When did you know you were going to make it, that you really, was that the breakthrough, Piano Man, or was it?
I didn't really trust, it was called a turntable hit. It didn't sell a huge amount of records. In those days, disc jockeys played a lot of what they wanted. This is the early 70s.
Yeah.
And it was free-form, progressive radio. Disc jockeys were spinning kind of what they wanted to an extent. The programming was a lot looser. And they liked this song. Whether it sold or not, they liked it anyway. And they would get calls, requests to play the thing. But I didn't feel at that time that that was a big turning point in my life in terms of being a success or making a breakthrough. That had actually happened a few years earlier. When I was about 19, I got my first paycheck as a musician that covered the rent and food. And I could quit this job I had at the factory.
Your day job.
Yeah, that was the big breakthrough. I realized I could actually make a living at this.
Yeah.
And there's been very few things after that that have topped that feeling.
That you, I can do what I want to do and what I feel that my talent is
Make
a living at it.
I can make
a living. I can be happy.
Right. I can do what I love and make ends meet.
When you, what is it about rock and roll that there's so few? I think of you and I think of Elton John, you know, who are piano players, that in fact the piano drives the music. Why so few? I mean, the guitar has been the dominant instrument in rock and roll.
Yeah, guitar is a better instrument image-wise. It's easier to manipulate. You can make all kinds of sexy stage moves with a guitar. Yeah. It's almost phallic. Yeah. You can sleep with a guitar. You can't sleep with a piano. You can bring a guitar to the beach and strum along, and you can't bring a piano to the beach. It's more of a raucous instrument. The three-chord, 12-bar blues, which a lot of early rock and roll was based on, is easy for guitar players to play. Although in the early days you did have guys like Fats Domino and Little Richard and Jerry Lee Lewis.
This is a great story from you. This is one great line in which you're talking about Tutti Frutti. And you say that after young, especially young white kids, heard Little Richard sing and play Tutti Frutti, and then compared that to the Pat Boone version, it was all over.
Forget it.
Church was out.
It was out. Church was out. School was out. That was the end of that. You know, they tried to suppress this stuff.
I know they did, yeah.
In the late 50s and the early 60s, they thought they were going to control this rock and roll thing. And the urgency, the intensity, the passion of rock and roll came from the black artists. Little Richard, Chuck Berry, Fats Domino. You know, screaming this stuff. There was a sexuality
and
to
the
it.
White guys had a black sound, whether it was Elvis or Jerry Lee Lewis or...
The better, I think, the better white artists were actually trying to imitate the black artists. But when you heard Pat Boone saying Tutti Frutti, it was a wop wop, a loop wop, a lop, it was so polite, didn't mean anything anymore. Yeah. And when Little Richard did it, you knew exactly what he was talking about. That's it. And once a young white America heard this stuff, it was all over but the shout. Yeah. That's what they wanted.
Is that what you wanted, to be a rock and roll star, rather than to be a classical star, rather than to be something else?
I wasn't sure. You know, back in that time, I loved rock and roll, but I liked classical music, too. I didn't want to be a concert pianist. Unfortunately, when you took piano lessons when I was growing up, they were trying to train you to become a concert virtuoso, which I had no desire to be at all. It didn't look like these guys had an awful lot of fun. They all seemed to be all very high-strung and very unhappy people. And I wanted to be a happy guy and have fun. What I enjoyed about playing the piano more than anything was my ability to meet girls.
It'll do it, won't it?
Absolutely. I was never going to meet girls because I was the football hero or any kind of matinee idol looking guy.
But
you'd go to a party, you'd sit down, and everybody would be mingling. I'd go over in the corner, start playing the piano. I'd look up. Sure enough, there was a girl. I said, this thing is great.
It does it for me.
It was a communicator. It was a way for me to meet people.
You have said, though, that in terms of your evolution, your voice has changed. It's better now. It's more your voice today.
Well, today I have a cold. So
okay, well, not today, but yesterday or 6 weeks ago or a week ago, and you'll have it by. The other thing you've said is that you think of yourself first as a composer, then as a piano player, and then finally as a singer. But you say the piano playing talent hasn't changed a whole lot since you were 12.
I think I was a better piano player when I was 12 years old. I was in the thick of classical music lessons. I could sight read like a whiz. I was exercising every day. I was in very good shape technically as a piano player. I've gotten worse as a piano player, but better as a writer. I think one has to give so the other one can get better.
Yeah. So is that what means the most to you?
You know what? It all started with the piano playing. So I have to say, essentially, I don't call myself a pianist. I'm a piano player.
Yeah.
That's where it starts. Then I'm a composer of music. And to me, that's the more substantive element of what I do, is the composition.
It begins with music for you rather than lyrics.
It's always the music first. Always.
Mm. Is that true for most composers?
No, I understand people have many different ways of writing. Some people have other people write the lyrics. Elton doesn't write lyrics. He has Bernie Taupin writes the lyrics, and he sends them to Elton, and Elton writes the music after he sees the lyrics.
But think about these songs, because clearly here, if you look at Blonde Over Blue, which is about Christie, the music came to you before, or you knew that you were looking for some music that would say what you felt about her?
I really didn't know what I was looking for. I dreamed this stuff. Consciously, I have all these terrific ambitions and these great ideas. Well, this is the kind of album I'm going to do. And really, when it gets down to it, I have no control over it all. The writing process, once it started, once I opened the Pandora's box, it goes its merry way. There's a lot of serendipity involved.
But it goes in sequence here. These songs were created in sequence, and one begets the other, begets the other.
That's
so you
right.
go from No Man's Land, which is of a certain time, to getting down to Famous Last Words, which is kind of the end of...
Yeah.
Do you always do it in sequence?
No. Songs will begat other songs. Usually they come in little bursts of three or four, and then I'll hit a wall. And then I'll be dry for a while, and then I'll break through the wall and write another two or three. And that's how it usually goes. This album came very much bang, 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 bang. I don't think I hit the wall till the very last song, Famous Last Words. There was obviously something that I felt I needed to say, something I felt I needed to write that was going to write itself whether I wanted it to or not.
A minor variation. Is that an indulgence on this album?
For me, it is.
Yeah.
I'm writing a blues song.
Yeah.
I've never allowed myself to write a blues song. Who am I to write the blues? Little white boy from Levittown. Who the heck is he to have the blues? But I had to give in to the blues. Yeah. I was feeling that. And it felt good to say, some days I got to give right into the blues.
Yeah.
And it helped me to get through that stage, you know, almost a grieving process. Until you give in to grief, you can't get over it. I think there's a few stages of grief: shock, disbelief, anger, and then you just kind of feel down. And in a way, sometimes it's a good thing to do.
Before we go to, we got something from Lullaby. The grief you were feeling came from the fact that the lawsuit and all this having to do with the amount of money that you had lost and what it was going to do to your life.
It wasn't so much amounts of money. It wasn't even a matter of legal things. That the lawsuit part of it is a small part. It was the betrayal.
Yeah.
It was the realization that my judgment was so wrong that I could have, had something happened to me, my family would have been in dire straits.
You found out not only did you not have any money, that you were in deep debt.
That I was in a hole.
In a hole.
Yeah.
And that you had therefore to go out and earn money.
I had to start
and get
from scratch and pull myself up by my bootstraps. Now, one of the hardest things about this was realizing that there are some people that are broken. I always used to write from a very optimistic point of view about humanity. I believed there was always some essential goodness in every human being in the world. And maybe it's my age, I'm in my 40s, I began to realize that the stories about bad people weren't fairy tales. There are bad people in the world.
And you say, which is also optimistic, I mean pessimistic, that this in part was a search for justice, and there ain't no justice sometimes.
I feel that there is very little justice, if there's any at all. Obviously, there was a loss of faith, and then a search for justice, then a realization that there was no justice, there's only faith. There's only faith in things that you believe in, faith in things that sustain you.
Which is love.
Right.
What else?
Family, friendship, one's own abilities, one's own talents. Those are the things that really sustain us.
Tell me about Lullaby before we see this in the spotlight performance or rehearsal. What this song means to you, why you included it, and what it says to you.
It was written at the time as a classical piano piece. I wrote it on the piano, and I had no lyric for it. The working title was called A Loss of Faith. And one night, my daughter was about six at the time, and she asked the question, as all children will ask their mom and dad, what happens when you die? What is this dying thing? What is that? And I thought, should I tell her about heaven and the angels and all that stuff, or should I tell her what I really believe deep down? And it worked its way into this lullaby, which became the lyric for this classical piece of music that I had, and hopefully answered her question. She seemed to like the answer I gave her in this song.
She likes this cut.
Yeah.
Okay. Here it is from a PBS special with Billy Joel in the spotlight on October 13th. Here is an excerpt from that production.
Good night, my angel, now it's time to sleep. And still so many things I want to say. Remember all the songs you sang for me when we went sailing on an emerald bay. And like a boat out on the ocean, I'm rocking you to sleep. The water's dark and deep inside this ancient heart. You'll always be a part of me.
I said to you that I like the album, I'm a little bit older than you are. I'm 51. You're, 44, 45 now. And it speaks to me. You say what? That it, in a sense, that it is a reflection of coming of age for you, not only as a musician, but as a human being.
Well, for a long time, this rock and roll generation that I grew up in, call it the baby boom, whatever you want to call it, avoided growing up. We never really thought we were going to hit the graying time. The middle age was a no-no. We were the Pepsi generation. We were the eternally young people, and here we are. We're in our 40s. We're looking at middle age. Has anyone dealt with this musically? Now, I had assumed and I'd hoped that people like Bob Dylan, Paul Simon were going to light the way. Mm-hmm. And talk about middle age and talk about what it was all about. And they didn't. Bob went into a very spiritual phase, and Paul went to South Africa and Brazil. And things got very vague for them. Maybe that was their way of dealing with it. But I wanted to confront it head on. I thought, why not talk about being middle aged? It's not as bad as I thought it was going to be.
And say what about it, other than it's not as bad as I thought about it. And here's what I hear you saying, is you're talking about sort of what you find is important in middle age to your life, which is your relationships, family, things that are sort of obvious to us, but we expect the poets and the songwriters among us to express our own feelings about them.
Yeah, our parents told us things when we were young, and we rejected a lot of it because it's natural for us to try to find our own way. I find this age has to do with throwing away a lot of excess baggage. Not so much taking on all these great, eurekas and answers to things. It's a lot of it is not nickel and diming, prioritizing, having appreciation of things that were always there, that we were maybe just too caught up in ourselves to see.
What are the misconceptions about you now that when you read about Billy Joel, do you say, this is a conventional wisdom about me that's not true?
I think the angry young man thing is not true. I wrote that song actually about somebody else.
Yeah.
And then I got tagged with being the angry young man, or referring to myself as the angry young man, which I don't think I am.
Yeah. Also, there was this notion of you being the amateur boxer too, and there was the...
Yeah, that I'm somehow aggressive and kind of bullying. I'm anti-bullying. I've watched people get pushed around, and I don't like it. If that means I'm feisty, and if that means I will stick up for myself, so be it. But I think that's a misconception, too.
What have been the critical turns for you? For example, the Russian tour, going to Russia in 1987. An important trip for you?
Probably the most intense series of concerts that I ever did was in the Soviet Union.
Why?
Because it was still the Soviet Union.
Yeah.
The evil empire, as Ronald Reagan called it. The Cold War was still very much there. My generation had grown up with this horrific fear of nuclear annihilation. I thought I'd go see for myself. And the minute we played for these people, the Cold War ended for me. It was a great weight had been lifted off of me. That was it. There was no more enmity, no more fear, no more paranoia. I knew we weren't going to have a war with these people. And I thought, how could the press, how could politicians have missed this great insight? All you got to do is meet these people and know they can't even make toilet paper. They're not going to fight a war with us. It was ridiculous. I think Norman Mailer said something very similar about his visit to the Soviet Union. He came to the same conclusion.
And how did they feel about rock and roll?
They love rock and roll. They love American music. Our culture, our popular culture, has been a very, very important export of ours without us realizing it until very recently, I think. They love blue jeans. Yeah. They love movies. They love our junk food. They love our rock and roll.
Yeah.
It means a lot to
our
a lot of
people. Our culture has had more of an impact than our politics.
I think so.
Although you could look at democratic values and say that that now is a pervasive influence in Eastern Europe, although democracy is having a tough time.
Sure, but our culture was a byproduct of our politics anyway. It was allowed to happen. We were allowed to have all this free time.
Right.
We were allowed to have all this leisure time. Kids were allowed to have a lot of freedom.
Freedom beget our culture.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Let me take another look. This is Downeaster Alexa, another clip from Billy Joel. Here it is. I wanted to go to this before, and I'll go right to it now so that we can take a look at this. This is A Matter of Trust, which is from
The
Bridge.
Right.
All right, here it is. Roll tape, and we'll take a look at this, and then we'll come back. Here it is. When I look at that, either in Moscow or in Leningrad, wherever that particular concert was, and you're talking about if anything that'll happen in the evolution, you'll continue to write music and continue to sing, but you'll take less and less performance, less and less concert. I think of the people who are our age and your age, who are lawyers and doctors and accountants. If they could do that, if they could have one moment to stand up in front of an audience and sing rock and roll, it would make their life, you know?
It would. It's a lot of fun. There's very few things that I can compare it to, you know. There's the old analogy, well, it's like great sex. But it's...
Is it?
It's beyond even that. It's a lot of fun.
Everything that you'd ever hoped to be, you do.
It's everything you think it is. It really is.
Yeah. You have always had a social conscience. You've always wanted to. Tell me a little bit about the battle that you've had. We saw in Downeaster, Alexa, this battle that you've had with the sports fishermen because you came down on the side of the commercial fishermen.
Well, where I live is the east end of Long Island. There are very few actual working commercial fishermen left. The quality of the water has driven a lot of the fishery down. State regulations are working against them, and then you've got a group of sport clubs that don't want the commercial fishermen catching the fish that they like to catch for sport. And I came in on the side of the commercial fishermen, and I got embroiled in a pretty hefty controversy.
And what
about
happened?
Well, I read editorials about how I slaughter fish and that I'm a dilettante and I'm a make-believe working man, which kind of bugs me because I work for a living. Some of these people accuse me of being a multimillionaire. Well, I didn't inherit this money. I worked for this money, and I worked hard for it. But I hate to see a small group of people get pushed around because they have no political power base and no money, and I would hate to see them disappear because in a lot of ways commercial fishermen defined the island that I grew up on. And once they're gone, I don't even know if it's an island anymore.
When people refer to you as a balladeer, those that do, do you like that or not like that? Or do you care?
It used
their labels?
It used to bother me. I do write ballads, so I'm not going to deny that partially I'm a balladeer. Sure, yeah. That's okay.
It's all right.
It's okay. It's not everything, but it's okay.
Yeah. Because, you know, you have made the comparison, others have, that the Beatles wrote battles too.
Right.
But they weren't thought of as a group.
Well, they were a band. I think a band has more of a rock and roll image than a singer-songwriter. The singer-songwriters tend to get lumped into the softer stuff, Joni Mitchell, James Taylor, Jackson Browne. Yeah. And that's the era I came up in. And we're thought of as more pensive and more thoughtful and quieter.
Yeah, but some people say on this album, there's not that coming from you, but something else. That this sound is a little bit different. That this is a different band for you. You made some changes. A different producer here, mm-hmm. Danny Kortchmar.
Right.
You define it for me.
Well, we used a different rhythm section. It was more of a groove section. My band plays more like a what I call a garage band or a club band, a bar band. These guys are more groove players. There was more guitar in the forefront of the production, less keyboard.
And that's because of Danny's influence as a producer?
Yeah, Danny Kortchmar had a particular vision of how we wanted the production to sound. It's a lot more mid-rangey, crunchier. There's a bit more distortion in it. And I think it brought a lot of the rock and roll aspects of my material out.
Yeah. You hope that, I mean, if this says anything, this album says anything about you, it says what?
It says I've moved along. It says I've made a stretch, and I've grown, and I'm continuing to go forward, because I would hate to remain static. I don't like sitting still.
And we have here, I think, River of Dreams. Take a look at this. This is, I think, the music video from this. And I want to see this before we move on and talk about some other things. Here it is. What musicians have influenced you? We were talking about North Carolina and James Taylor, who's also from North Carolina. Who has influenced you? What people who do you connect with to talk about music, to listen to music, who might have something to say that resonates with you?
In rock and roll, it have to be the Beatles. The Beatles were the ultimate influence on me. I grew up listening to the Beatles. They grew up as I was growing up. They changed, they metamorphosized, they evolved.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was always enchanted by what the Beatles did as writers and as a band. A lot of R&B artists influenced me. Ray Charles, James Brown, Wilson Pickett, Sam Cooke, Joe Tex. I love those guys. Classical music, Beethoven had a big influence on me still.
Also,
it's undeniable, you know, the impact that Beethoven has had on Western music. I think you can find heavy metal in the Beethoven symphonies. Yeah. You can find ballad. You can find romance. You can find angst, sturm und drang, struggle and victory. Everything is in Beethoven. Mozart had an influence on me. Jazz musicians did. Broadway shows had an influence on me. I think Hendrix, a lot of people might have difficulty understanding why would a keyboard player
be
relate to
by
Jimi
a guitarist,
Hendrix.
Right?
I loved Jimi Hendrix.
And what was it, though?
His musicality. Mm-hmm. He was so musical. He was undeniably musical. If he didn't play the guitar, he would have been a phenomenal keyboard player. He happened to play guitar and set the thing on fire. Yeah. And in more ways than one. he was brilliant. Cream, I loved the band Cream. I also loved Traffic, Steve Winwood. I think my influences would probably go up to about the year 1970. That was about it.
Yeah. Why, though? Why did it stop then? I've heard other people say the same thing. That sort of the things that really mattered to them stopped in the 70s, and no one else.
It may have been the age. You know, in 1970, I was 21, and all that teenage stuff sort of came to an end when I was 21. There is something magic about that age.
Do you care what the critics say and how they define you? I mean, a lot of people will say, I have read things about you in which they say, look, here's a guy who is one of the best tunesmiths of our time, right, you know, of the last couple of decades. And why don't they take him and accept how good he is for that? You know?
It used to bother me when I thought they missed the boat. But rarely, even in a good review, do you see somebody goes, sounds good to me.
Yeah.
It's as simple as that.
Sounds good
sounds
to
good.
Me.
Sounds good. Makes a nice noise. Sounds good. Which is how music always hit me. I'd never tried to intellectualize or analyze music that I liked, because in a way that might destroy it. It hits me emotionally, and I can't explain. It's like love. How do you explain love? You can't explain it. How do you explain the way something smells, the way something tastes, the way something feels? That's how music hits me. So I've gotten beyond being upset by a review. If I disagree with it, vive la différence. Everyone's entitled to their opinion.
And what about the gossip columnists and all those people, the tabloids?
I found out that's just part of this funny job that I have. You must get a certain amount of that. You know?
Unfortunately, yeah. But Christy probably has a better understanding of that than either you or me does, of how they go, and that you have to, you know, it's like all the photographers when you walk in somewhere, that you can't look the other way.
No.
Because they're looking for a picture.
Well, she taught me.
Go ahead.
You know, she taught me a great lesson. I'm sorry to interrupt. But, you know, I used to be in the Sean Penn school of trying to, you know, getting mad at the photographer and holding up my hands, and they would get the picture of me that looked
terrible,
like that. And Christy would say, she calls me Joe. She goes, Joe, just give them their shot. Yeah. Give them a good, you know, give them your best shot. So I went, okay, and I learned from her.
And then they're happy, happy, and you can go on in. Why does she call you Joe?
When we met, she thought I was the penultimate New York guy. And Billy didn't strike her as enough of a New York name, so she called me Joe. Just like, you just sound like a Joe, like a regular Joe. And it stuck.
Yeah. Was this like love at first sight? Was this, I mean, it's easier for you to have had that impression.
For me, it was.
Yeah, that's what I would say.
Absolutely.
I mean, like, what else is there?
I don't think she was that impressed with me. I
saw her. Oh, my rock and roll star?
I don't think she even really knew who I was. I saw her getting on a plane to go to this island in the Caribbean, and I said, that's Christy Brinkley. I recognized her immediately, and I tried to get her to recognize me. No, I couldn't get on the same plane. She was on a different plane. But we were in lines that were parallel, and she was right next to me. And I'm trying to look like me. I'm trying to do what I call throwing an album cover.
Yeah.
Just right by her. And then I met her a few days later in a little restaurant. I was playing the piano. And there she was.
In New York or somewhere else?
In the Caribbean.
This was St. Bart's, wasn't it?
In St. Bart's.
Right.
And there I was playing the piano. I looked up. There's Christy Brinkley.
See,
again.
The piano again helps you meet.
What a terrific thing this is. And we got to talking, and we were friends at first. I was nuts about her. But it took a while for her to, you know, reciprocate.
So, and what are you saying to her in these two, Blonde Over Blue and... what's the other one? About her.
All About Soul?
All About Soul, yeah.
Well, Blonde Over Blue is about obsessions, and I use Christy as the muse. I mean, in times of desperation, men turn to the comfort of a woman for some relief, for some release from the things that are troubling them. Had I called it brunette over blue, you know, Christy would have said, oh, really?
What the hell's going on here?
Who's the brunette? All About Soul really is a substantive song about the support of a loving woman or a loving mate. Yeah. Because I think under love there's something even stronger, which is soul, which is the thing that sustains love. When love has a tough time, one must dig deeper. And that's what soul is all about.
I'm struck by, because you talk about coming to grip with the blues and you feel it here because of what you've gone through, what a powerful impact. Now, I don't want to minimize it. What a powerful impact this notion of what this business about losing, not put a figure on it, but trusting somebody and having them betray your trust, which is the subject of the Great Wall of China, that song, of the impact that's had on you. I mean, it almost went to the very core of your life.
It created a great crisis for me as a writer. How was I going to write now the same way? Because I could never see people the same way again.
Yeah. Because something essential had been violated.
My naivety was gone. My innocence about human nature was gone. My belief that everything is going to be okay as long as you do the right thing. That was gone. And I wondered, how am I going to write anymore, because I don't believe that anymore. I'm not the optimist I was. And actually making this album helped me get through that, because I realized there are, for a couple of bad eggs, there's still a lot of really, really good things about people. I came to that conclusion.
The love and...
The people who are loyal to you, the people who support you, the ones who give love unquestioningly, you know, and... The people that you can continue to trust in, because there are people like that also. So I didn't give up on humanity, but it took me a while to learn that. Yeah.
But that's also combined with No Man's Land, which is way away from that subject, which is much more social commentary.
Well, that was, I felt like, an Old Testament prophet, railing at the whole thing is corrupt, we're all damned. I had to get that out of my system.
Where do you think you'll be 5 years from now? I mean, what do you think you'll be doing? You won't be touring as much.
No.
Yeah. You'll still be writing music.
I'll still be writing. I may be writing other types of music. I may try to write a Broadway musical. I may try to write orchestral music. I may be writing for other people. I'd like to write for someone other than me and my own vocal limitations. I got a cold. Yeah. I'm more aware of it today than the other day. Writing in other mediums, maybe movie scores. I don't know. I don't really know. But it will always be something to do with music. You know. It's funny, people send me movie scripts as if, okay, now it's time for you to make the transition from rock star to movie star, as if music isn't enough.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, music is enough. Music is more than enough for me, and I will spend the rest of my life exploring it and being enchanted by it.
Do you play every day? I mean, do you touch the keyboard every day?
No. No, I don't. Some days I stay away from it on purpose. I don't want it to become something I take for granted. I don't want it to become something that's too expected, something that I'm, you know, too familiar with.
Yeah. And if you hear a lyric, I mean, you have to hear the music first, do you?
Yes.
Yeah. So you never have lyrics that you write down and.
I do. I have a little notebook and I keep note of certain lyric thoughts that I have, but it's usually better for me to start from the musical point of view.
Yeah. And what do you hear in the musical point of view? Is it a beat? I mean, what is it that comes to your mind?
There's an emotion. I always use the example of Beethoven's Fifth. Ba-ba-ba-ba. What does that mean? And to me it means it's destiny knocking on the door. Maybe at the time it could have been something as mundane as the landlord going, what's with the rent? You know, the old lady upstairs, stop with the noise. Who knows? But there is an inherent lyric in that musical message. And that to me is what I'm looking for when I write the music. I say, what is this music saying? Da 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 da. What does it mean?
Yeah. And where you go is somewhere in your head where there are these other thoughts that are going on, whether it is about.
It really almost has nothing to do with me. It's the pure emotion that is expressed in the music is something that the lyric must convey.
Why have you survived in a very tough business? I mean, there are not that many who have been able to. You know, you just said 20 years from Piano Man to this album. What is it you think that's given you an ability? I think 10 out of most of the albums have been platinum. There've always been a song that has struck a chord.
Well, number one, I love music. I'm enchanted by it. I approach it as a fan. What I do for me. I don't do in terms of thinking about an audience or critics or what's going to be commercial. I just do what I do because I want to hear something. I write for me, so I'm writing for a fan.
Yeah. You're writing for yourself, not for an audience, and you don't see six...
It's too abstract. What's an audience? Yeah. You know, I know what it is when I go up on stage. I'm working with other musicians, and I want them to like what I'm doing, too, so there's that element of it. But essentially, I don't think what I do is extraordinary. Now, and this is not false humility. What I do is, to me, not extraordinary at all. I feel that I'm competent. I know how to write music. I know how to play music. And I'm merely competent. However, I'm doing this in what I think is an age of extreme incompetence. Yeah. And that makes me extraordinary. Yeah. That's why I think I've survived. Because I know how to do what I'm doing, and a lot of people don't.
I hate to do this to you, but I am anyway. You know, I mean, what are the four or five, just give me the four or five songs that mean the most to you that you have written?
That's tough. Because they're like children. And how do you pick your four or five favorite kids? They would usually be the newer songs.
They would be from Here and from Storm.
They're the ones I'm closer to, the ones I'm not that far away from childbirth with.
Yeah.
It's always, you know, look at the new baby, isn't the new baby special? My favorite song, I would have to tell you right now, is the last song on this album called Famous Last Words. I just really love that song a lot. Again, it's the newest one. It's my newest baby. It's the freshest one. And I like the construction of it, and I admire the song as a piece of song craft. Other songs, I'd have to look at a whole list of them.
Yeah.
Some of them grow up to be great, you know, accomplished pieces of work, and some of them don't grow up so good.
I love them all. It's great to have you here, and I love many of them. Billy Joel, River of Dreams, he's at Madison Square Garden, he's on a world tour. You're on a world tour, are you not?
Long world tour.
It's great to have you, bro.
Thanks, Charles.
Let's do it again.
Okay.
Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time.